Creating the set list for the Acropolis tour was not an easy task, because I know a lot of the songs that are favorites that people must hear, but also the concert is going to last 2.5 hours. So I must try to play as many of the Acropolis songs as I can in their entirety, because a lot of times I tend to make them into medleys, so I can fit more songs per concert. I pretty much knew right away which songs had to be there. And they are. But also, again, that's where the past and the present become one. Here's something I've never said before. I was told by someone very dear to me and very close to me that if you win this battle, if you actually manage to make the impossible possible and go to Greece and perform at the Herodoticus Theater, you're a Superman like with kryptonite. You lose your strength when you're there, because it brings back all the memories of weaknesses when you were younger and all the bad things that happened. And, you know, when you're a young kid, you don't have as much strength, as much power over what your life is going to be like. All the issues that arose when I was a kid showed up. And she told me that if I was able to complete this task, all that would go away. Guess what? It did. It did. I was free. I never said this before. This is the first time. I was free all of a sudden. I just realized, okay, I'm done with this part. I have accepted the challenge, and I have emerged victorious on the other end. Thank you very much. I accept. I'm not trying to recreate the Acropolis. I'm celebrating the fact I'm here, that I can play these songs 25 years later, and people are interested to come and see it. I know how much this particular event has meant for millions of people around the world. How many families have come together? How many generations of people? I see 6-year-olds and mom and grandma and grandpa, and you can look down on my audience and you can see a guy with tattoos and a leather jacket, biker, right next to grandma, and they're both going like this. I didn't write music to do that. Nobody can do that. I wrote music because I loved that particular piece of music. It spoke to me. It expressed my emotion. And then it's like a baby. Once you let it go your studio, you have no control over it. You send it out to the world. And the world does with it what the world wants to do with it. Some people enjoy it a lot, and apparently it crossed generation barriers, language barriers, and I've said it many times before. The world's language is music. What I can tell the fan is that this is one of the most important turning points in my life and in my career, and it definitely has left its mark in the world. I wanted people to see this concert forever. I wanted it to go out there. I wanted to tell them what happened. And you know what they say, if it's not on video, it never happened. I started that 25 years ago, I was saying that. When I came up with the idea, I was in Kalamata, in my hometown, on the balcony on a summer night with a couple of my friends. And one of them said, you know, I saw a picture of the Herodoticus Theater, and I think that's where someday you should do a concert. And I went, yeah, okay, sure. How are we going to get in there? Who's going to let us take that over and put lights in? You know, that's impossible. That was 2 years before the actual concert took place. The idea stuck with me, and I kept looking at it, and I'm going, I know it's impossible, but I love the impossible tasks. It's like, as soon as you say the word impossible, you just turn the key to magic for me. It was like I put it in my mind and I did not want to let it go. I was going to make that happen. Took my breath away when I began, and it began looking like it was going to happen. It began looking like, well, we'll consider it, we'll see how it goes. And a lot of talking and a lot of red tape, of course, as you can imagine. I was told it will fail. I wasn't just told, don't do it. I wasn't just told, well, you have a chance. I was told by everybody around me, with the exception of a couple of members of my close family and a couple of friends, who said, do it, just do it. If you can pull this off, just do it. It's going to be magical. The rest of them went, not only we're not going to support you, we're not going to give you any money. I dare say my record companies. Everybody. They just say, absolutely not. Don't do it. You're going to fail. This is doomed to fail. You're going to become poor. You're going to lose all your money. And it's going to go for a dive in the ocean. I love a challenge. I just love that. When they went and said that to me, I went, okay, now I'm going to teach you a life lesson. Watch me do it. When the magic happened, I knew it. I knew I had something that is unrepeatable. People have to understand that. This is unrepeatable. You can never do this again. No one can do this again, not even I. Even if you told me the next day, do it again, it wouldn't be the same. It was that particular moment in time encapsulated that captured the magic and also makes it magical. Later, as the years went by, 25 to be exact, I thought, is there any way to take this VHS and turn it into 1080p, 16:9, improve and enhance the experience without destroying the magic that it contains in it, without fixing it too much? You can't just go in there and take something that's classic, like the Acropolis concert, and start pushing things around and making, oh, it looks better, sounds better. So what? But you just ruined it. So I approached it with a very light touch. I do believe that in 2018, my music has taken a very important new meaning. I think people are beginning to catch on and catch up with what was there and what is there and what's there to come. We haven't heard myriads and myriads of stories about the healing power of my music, how people use them in any imaginable way you can. It can cross your mind, from going through chemotherapy and the pain, unbearable pain and loss of a loved one in the family, child, father, mother, being sick, coming off from accidents, from car accidents, being in a bed for 4 years and still being able to walk. I actually just saw recently somebody that came to my concert, and he could not walk. He had been in an accident, and he made sure that he stood up for me. I kept saying, no, no, no. It was at the end of the concert. I kept saying, no, sit, sit, sit. I knew who he was. And no, he insisted, and the two people beside him just helped him get up, and he got up. He insisted, you know, I mean, how do you get so deep inside hearts, people's hearts, that they want to do this for you? It's pretty amazing. I have played with some of the best musicians on the whole planet. And there's so many that if I brought them all together again, probably have a band of 120 people. It would be an amazing band, but it's an impossible task. That cannot be done. The musicians that I take with me, first of all, they have small prerequisites. They have to be the best in the world. They have to be great human beings. They have to get a great spirit of giving and be nice to their fellow musicians and teach each other. This is not a competition. This is camaraderie. It's a team. I put together a team. And they all care about each other. And you will see that on stage, the way they look at each other. And if somebody's getting in trouble, some wire is getting tangled in somebody's feet or the shoe or something is not happening right, the person next to them will immediately run and fix whatever they look. They pay attention about everybody. They know that Samuel is about to get up to do a concert, to do a solo. And if he gets up and they know that his wire is caught behind on the chair and he can't move, they'll go and lift the chair, pull the wire, and everything's fine. The good teacher should work with her natural abilities and enhance those rather than trying to say, oh, don't do that, don't play this, don't play that. We don't do this in Western music. We don't do this in Eastern music. We do anything we want. There are no rules in music. Music, again, is the world's language, and everybody understands. So you be yourself, you will be original, because there's only one of you on this planet. All it takes is you have to love it, you have to have a passion for it. In other words, they can't keep you away from your instrument, whether it's the violin, the guitar, the piano, the drums, whatever it is. And the brilliance comes with that. Since I was young, I always tried to materialize things that I heard in my head. A lot of people say that to me. They say, you know, I hear music in my head and then I can't make it materialize. How can I do that? Well, that's how I started too. And then the more you make it materialize I figured out how to write it down on a piece of paper with my own little shorthand, and then I would try to play it on the piano, and that process got better and faster and better and faster, and pretty soon I realized I don't need to write anything down because I will never forget it, because I have facts in a studio where I would record 2 hours of me playing the piano, and in there I would find 6 themes that I have not recorded yet, that I have yet on another tape. They reappear. If you've been there, in that area, that neighborhood of music, it reappears. So as I shortened, I called it the process of destruction. It's like when I hear a piece of music and I go to my tape recorder and I begin with my keyboards and my piano and whatever else, try to make it real so you can hear it. I call that the process of destruction because a lot of times you don't get what you originally hear in your mind. Everything in your mind is perfect. It doesn't, it's everything is in tune, nobody's out of time, everything is played perfectly. And yet when you try to translate it, a lot of nuances are lost in the translation. Much like a painter would try to paint something that they see in their mind's eye, but it doesn't quite come out as they thought of it. The whole idea is I realized how short could I make the distance between perception and reality. How close can I make that distance? Could I make it almost nothing? Or could I make it nothing? In other words, take myself out of the way. Any physicist will tell you that as you shorten the time, the energy explodes exponentially. The shorter the time, the more the energy. I believe that nowadays I have reached the point of I'm out of the process. I'm merely a catalyst. I hear something and it exists. Because I have the ability to go to the studio and do it. I don't have to write it down. I don't have to discuss it. And I am proficient enough with my equipment because I know how to use all these knobs, believe it or not, plus play the keyboards. I understand the process. So I'm out of the way. It's instant. I have been on airplanes coming from Asia back to America and turning around to few of my friends that are flying with me and saying, I know how the next concert is going to open. And I sing the beginning to them. I say, it's going to start with these drums on that rhythm, and then we're going to go at the beginning of that. Then we're going to go this, and then we're going to do that, and then like that, and then we're going to count off 4 more beats, and then it's going to start with that song. And I knew it within a minute. Well, people were storing their suitcases above my head. It's true. You can ask around. And then when we got home, and I actually did it, all these people who heard it said, we understood it when you said it to us. It's exactly what you said it was going to be. I didn't realize it. It's only by talking, trying to explain to people what's happening, where music comes from, how do you reach those levels, why does it appear sometimes, and sometimes you can't come up with anything. You know, it's a level. You have to reach a level where you leave your baggage outside the studio door. We say that. There's no ego here. There's no nothing. It's just the less of the bags from your life that you bring into this particular studio. And I love my studio. This is my place. This is a place of keep the lights down and create. You know, having started from where I started with the Acropolis as an idea, which blossomed into let's do it, which blossomed into becoming very strong because of the opposition I received, which turned me on to reach these levels. I remember when we finished it, It was completely broke. And we were sitting in Los Angeles outside Edit Bay, sitting on the pavement. And cars were driving by with my director back there. And I was looking. I said, George, do you think this is going to sell? That's how humble I was. And I didn't know how many people would understand what I just did. And he went, oh, for sure, at least 100,000 copies. I looked at him and went, are you kidding me? You know, it took millions of dollars to make this. What am I going to do with 100,000 back? It doesn't work. To watch it just take off. And it didn't take off right away. And I won't mention networks, but they were resistant in playing it. It started with 3-4 stations at the beginning, and they made a lot of money. And then 3 more came on. The big McGillas all over this country were going, no way, we're not playing any of this stuff. Because it was shot like a football game. He had colors, he had the musicians, the Brits looked magnificent. It was the thing. It was the first one of its kind. I could not believe, you know, pinch me, and we were talking, you know, is this real? What is going on? We're on the main album charts on Billboard. We were number 2 on video sales behind Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, which nobody can beat that. And they were selling it as a movie on VHS. It went 10 times platinum. And it was the only concert that went everywhere in the world. It's been viewed by billions of people. It's 25 years old when I was talking about the lines on the maps, which is very true today. You watch those lines move around a lot. And as they move, a lot of people lose their lives. And we keep doing it. And I was talking about the astronaut back then, looking down over Europe, not being able to countries apart from each other. I can't either. You take the lines off the maps, where does Germany end and where does Austria begin? Go ahead, show me. Take the lines off the maps even in America. Go ahead. I mean, you could tell where Florida is. That's where we are. Or you can see where England is. There's a few places you can tell approximately. But other than that, these lines are imaginary. They don't exist. I started saying all that back then, and it holds true today. Makes me love it even more. The thinking process is anything that comes to my mind, I let it come in, I think about it, take it to the end. As long as it wants to be there, it's there. Even though I'm sitting here in this particular room writing music and looking for music, I don't control my mind into, you must give me some music now. I just stay quiet. Most people can't do that. They have to have a TV on, they have to be talking to somebody, reading something, looking at their computer, or there's got to be some noise around. There's weird when it's dead silence. All of a sudden, I'm thinking about this, I'm thinking about that. Even life's mysteries become transparent. Truths come to me. I've asked for only truths from life. Please, I don't need lies. I don't need, sugar-coated stuff. Just tell me the truth. I can handle the truth. Just tell me the truth. That's all I want. And life accommodates you. It just brings you truth. If you go back in my career, not to sound conceited, I only did what I wanted to do. And I always did that. And if you watch the Acropolis, one of the documentaries, it wasn't that the Acropolis actually used. My own mother said, you know him, he only does what he wants to do or what he likes to do. She gave me up. That's it. That was the secret. I never followed any trends. Since when? They didn't know what to do with me when I started doing music. What kind of music is that? I didn't care. I liked it. I do what I like. If I like it, it goes out. If I don't like it, it's gone. People hear me say, no, it's okay. Don't throw that away. No, I don't like it. It's gone. It's what I like. And that's, how long is a song? As long as I require it to be. If I have things to say, it'll be this long. If I run out of things to say and I've said everything I need to say and expressed everything I need to express, It will be 2 minutes and 45 seconds, like one man's dream. Well, I could play it for 8 minutes, but I didn't need to. I said everything I wanted to say. I'm done. On the other hand, if I play a song like Deliverance, which I played for the Taj Mahal, it's over 7 minutes long. I don't remember how long it is because I had a lot of things to say. I wrote it just like the old composers did. There is no verse, chorus, bridge, chorus, 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 chorus. The standard formation of a radio hit. I never wrote for radio. I just wrote music. I mixed electronics with acoustics. Who did that? Nobody. Now everybody's doing it. All of a sudden I'm watching movies and I'm hearing my music in them. I'm hearing blends of electronics and acoustics, and I'm also hearing quite a lot of 7/8s in there. They started about 5 years ago, and I recognize one of them now unabashedly. They use it in every chase scene or anything that happens in the movie. It's like, here comes a 7. Doom, 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 doom. Would you stop stealing? Actually, it's not stealing. It's a form of flattery anyway. So that means they like it. Thank God they liked something I did. It's good. There's a shot on the Acropolis where the camera is right above me. We've never been able to do a shot like that. The poor guy, the camera guy, is up about 60, 50 feet in the air from the wall on probably a platform about this big with a camera at the end, and he's hanging in midair shooting straight down at the piano. And so I have a shot that you can see both of my hands above the piano. I'm going, George, you're crazy. If this guy falls, we're going to be in trouble. But that was George. There was no shot he couldn't get. He was going to get the most amazing shots. Another shot, too, that I'm very proud of. How we manage to have me play the piano, and I'm playing Felita. And you can see my father and my mother and Linda, my Linda, Linda Evans, sitting, and they're the only people lit specifically for that shot. If you look during Felita, you will see me level, eye level. I'm here playing the piano, the camera is this way, sitting straight across from me, and you can see my mom and dad right there. That's not so easy to get. We've never been able to get anything like that again. And that's because the ball was going up. This is the happy accidents I was talking about. So we got lucky a lot. I think it had a lot to do with my praying too, but but we got lucky a lot. And I like that. We accept miracles is my favorite word. We accept miracles.